Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the 23rd meeting of the Equalities and Human Rights Committee. Our first item of business is our first evidence session on the United Nations Convention on the Rights of the Child, Incorporation Scotland Bill. We'll hear from two witness panels this morning, and I'm grateful to all witnesses for their attendance. If I can welcome witnesses on our first panel, Dr. Katie Boyle, Associate Professor of International Human Rights Law, University of Stirling, Professor Eileen McCarr, Professor of Public Law and Human Rights at Durham University, Professor Kenneth Norrie, Law School, University of Strathclyde, and Professor Elaine E. Sutherland, Professor of Child and Family Law at the University of Stirling. And thank you for all being with us this morning. We will move to questions shortly. I'd like to remind members that if your question is addressed to a specific witness, to identify that witness by name. Otherwise, we'll work to the order in which witnesses appear on the agenda. Witnesses, if you feel you have nothing to add in response to a question, please don't feel you have to speak and simply state so. We've quite a lot to get through today in a limited amount of time, and I appreciate we're working with this wonderful technology as well as the technical details of the bill. I'd encourage members and witnesses to keep questions and answers succinct to allow us to get through as much as possible. In broadcasting, if you allow them a few seconds to operate your microphones or beginning to ask your question or provide an answer. Now, if we can move to questions, and I'd like to start, please. There's strong support for direct incorporation of the UNCRC into Scots law. Committee, I'd like to hear your views on taking this approach, and if you could speak to potential benefits or disadvantages indeed of the approach that's been taken. And if I could go to Dr. Katie Boyle first, please.
Hey, good morning. Thank you, convener, and thank you to all of you for the opportunity to come speak to you about this today. I would just say that, first of all, in terms of the benefits of the bill, it's almost self-evident in a sense that if you introduce better rights protections for children, children will have better access to those rights. And I think what is particularly innovative about this approach is that it uses existing public law remedies that already exist. So we're very familiar with the framework and the way that we already protect those rights under the ECHR. And also that there are quite innovative mechanisms to ensure that if something goes wrong, children will have access to a remedy. What's particularly welcome is the fact that this idea of a remedy for in a court if all else fails is a really key important aspect of incorporation. And the way that the bill operates is that it embeds rights compliance in the work of the legislature to a degree, the work of the government and public authorities to a greater degree, and also offers the court a role in protecting rights. So that model of incorporation embeds rights compliance across those roles of the state. But there's scope to go a little further is enhancing the role of the parliament, making sure that public authorities are able to understand their duties and fulfil them in terms of what positive obligations they have. And finally, that the role of the court is clear in terms of what they can do and to meet the threshold of an effective remedy. And ultimately, if services are privatised, that there is accountability, human rights accountability for children in the privatisation of public services.
Okay, thank you. Professor Eileen McCarr, I see you were having some difficulties there with the technology. Are you okay for me to come to you? Are you hearing us?
I think so. I don't have a strong view on the desirability or otherwise of incorporating this particular convention. I do think it's a very interesting bill from the point of view of domestic protection of fundamental rights. It goes, as Dr. Boyle said, it goes in a number of ways beyond existing models in both the Human Rights Act and the Scotland Act. So
Professor McCarg, I think we're you seem to be freezing a bit there. I think we're losing you. If you don't mind, I'll go on to the next panel member and we'll come back to you, hopefully. Professor Kenneth Norrie, please. Advantages, potential benefits and any disadvantages of the approach that's been taken, please.
Okay, thank you. Good morning, everybody. The advantages in making children's rights absolutely central to policy making and law making and the way that public authorities operate are self-evident. The question is whether this is the right way to go about it. I would prefer a different approach. I'm not particularly keen on the structure itself of the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child for a whole host of reasons. One simple reason is that it's worded very much not in terms of rights. It imposes duties primarily on state signatories to the Convention, and of course we can interpret them as giving rights. But to me, good law is accessible law, and particularly if you're dealing with children and children's rights, if you want to be able to say children have rights to do X, Y, and Z, they have to know about it. And actually reading that the state has an obligation to protect X, Y, and Z doesn't actually help. I should much have preferred the bill to have gone through every one of us in the substantive rights in the UN Convention, converted it into a right. Let me just give you a simple example. There's one of the provisions in the Convention says that state parties have to set a minimum age of criminal responsibility. We in Scotland, of course, have done so very recently, or increased it very recently. It would have been the easiest thing in the world to say children below a certain age have a right to have their behaviour dealt with in a welfare-based system rather than by the criminal court. So that's just one example of what I should have preferred the approach to do. My other major problem with the UN Convention is a fear that once the Convention is incorporated, we think that's children's rights sorted. We don't need to go any further. We need to remember that the UN Convention sets minimum standards, and there's a lot of rights that are completely ignored in the UN Convention. And partly that's due to its history of a worldwide convention that tries to encourage every member state on the whole planet to buy into these rights. There's two very obvious things that are missing, for example. Of a child to his or her developing sexuality or gender identity doesn't appear. The right of a child not to be forced into marriage doesn't appear. So there's all sorts of other things which if we sat down afresh and decided what rights were appropriate for children in Scotland in 2020, we would have come up with a very different list, I think.
Thank you. That's very interesting. I'm going to come back to Eileen now, please. I think you're back with us.
Thank you. The point I wanted to make was sort of similar to Professor Norrie's point, which is the key way in which this differs from something like the Human Rights Act is that there is no body of authoritative interpretation of the Convention, which the Scottish courts are instructed to take into account. And so it gives a very wide degree of interpretive freedom to the courts. So what impact this will have in practice will be very much dependent on what the courts do with it or don't do with it. And as Professor Norrie said, if the structure of the convention is as duties rather than rights, it may have less impact than is anticipated. Thank you.
Thank you. And if I can come to Professor Sutherland now, please.
Hello, and again, thank you for giving me the opportunity to participate in this discussion. I would endorse everything that Dr. Boyle said. I think she summarised beautifully the many benefits of the convention and of incorporation. I take the point that, first of all, the convention, like any instrument, has the characteristics of its time. Where I would part company with Professor Norrie is, well, certainly he's quite right that the convention does not address squarely issues of gender identity. That's certainly true. But there's a lot of other material from the UN Committee on the Rights of the Child that elaborates on rights in the convention, the best example, and a number of others that allow for protection of those things. So it would be unlikely, even if we passed our own statute now, to cover that we might want to respect for children in the future. And of course, I think an important thing to mention is there is a sort of living element to it that comes about in a number of ways. I'd like to take the opportunity at this point to just make absolutely clear something that leads to misunderstanding about the convention. There are occasions when Scots law already goes with the convention. And one of the most obvious examples there is while the best interests of a child in the convention are simply a primary consideration, the welfare of the child in Scots law is generally the paramount consideration. Now, it's sometimes suggested in discussions about the convention that means that incorporating the convention will reduce children's rights. And I just wanted to make absolutely clear to the committee, in case any of the members were not aware of it, one of the UN convention makes it quite clear that where domestic law gives a child more rights, then the convention doesn't in any way diminish those. I just thought I'd clarify that one because it is a misunderstanding that floats out here. The other point I would pick up on is, well, of course, there is no court on the rights of the child equivalent to the European Court of Human Rights. So you don't have that kind of authoritative statement about interpretation. But there are a lot of other tools in the toolbox on interpretation. General comment, including observations of the UN Committee. And, of course, there is our Protocol 3 opinion of the UN Committee under that, where it deals with individual cases. Now, we were asked to keep our answers brief, so if you'd like me to expand on what I mean by those other resources from the UN Committee, I'd be happy to do so. But I don't want to run over on time there.
Okay, thank you. I think we'll have the opportunity to come back and go these things a little bit more as we move through the session. Those were helpful clarifications from everyone. We are having a little bit of a problem with sound and picture slightly dropping in and out, but we are gathering what you're saying. If it persists, we may turn off your video so that we can hear you loud and clear. Obviously, your words are the most important thing to us today. If we can move on to questions from the committee members. Mary Fee, please.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. There are a couple of areas of the bill that I'd like to expand on with the panel. The first is in Section 4 and the second is in Section 6 of the bill. So if I could, can I start with asking the panel about the interpretation of the UNCRC, which is set out in Section 4. So do the panel think that the interpretation should be expanded to take account of the Committee on the Rights of the Child general comments and concluding observations or any other international human rights opinions or treaties? And if it was expanded to take account, do the panel think there are any unintended consequences that would come about because of this? And the second area that I wanted to explore with the panel was the definition of a public authority. Now, the definition is laid out in Section 6, and there have been concerns raised about that definition. For example, we have heard that children's hearings would not automatically be defined as a public authority, and there are other agencies that would not be determined to be public authorities, and that could bring problems and issues. So should that definition be expanded to bring every single organisation under the umbrella or the scope of a public authority? And the second issue in relation to public authorities is around the panel's view on whether the bill is clear enough in what a public authority should do if it's faced with secondary legislation which is in force but is incompatible with the UNCRC requirements. And I'm sorry for making that question as long as it is, but in the interest of time, I wanted to try and get through as much as I could.
Thank you, Mary. If we can go to Katie, please.
Yeah, thank you very much. I'm glad you've asked this question about Section 4, and my colleagues have already picked up on it. The interpretation clause I would recommend is amended. I think Professor Norrie highlighted the fact that, you know, if without clear instructions around what rights mean in practice, it's very hard for both duty bearers as well as the judiciary when they interpret rights to know what they mean, and primarily, of course, children. And there are different models of incorporation and ways which that can be achieved, and one of them is direct incorporation of the treaty, which this bill seeks to do. Mm-hmm. A way to help address that critique, which is called the indeterminacy critique, it's basically that, you know, some rights in international law are too vague, is that you need to be able to have regard to all of those different instruments which help explain the substance and content of rights. And this is not the first time this has been tackled. So, for example, in the South African constitution, what you see is that the rights which include, you know, economic, social, cultural, environmental and children's rights are interpreted where the courts must have regard to international law and may have regard to comparative law to help them. And as Professor Sutherland's already highlighted, there is a body of jurisprudence, even although it's not technically a court, but it does take on a quasi-judicial function in the committee under the optional protocol to the convention. Now, that's not to suggest that if you were to include in that interpretative clause, which I think you it should happen, international human rights law, so other UN treaties, because you need to have reference to those other bodies in order to fully understand the way that the UNCRC has been developed and interpreted over time, particularly, for example, economic and social rights and children's economic and social rights, treaty body decisions, optional protocols, general comments, recommendations, and also comparative law. I think that would be the expansive form of interpretation clause that I would recommend. In terms of unintended consequences, I really think there may be a fear that that would suggest that, oh, you make all of those decisions binding, but that's not what an interpretative clause does. It asks the interpreter to have regard to those other instruments to help them understand the meaning of the rights. And ultimately, they can weigh up those different instruments and those different types of interpretations and give meaning and substance within the context of Scotland. So there is a margin of appreciation in terms of how those rights would be interpreted domestically, and that's the way international human rights law works. So the more help you give to the interpreter, whether that be the duty bearer, the child or the court, the easier it will make it. So without any kind of hesitation, I would recommend a more expansive, in fact, I would say it's necessary for the bill to work. In relation to the public authority question, for me, the major concern there is that the model employed mirrors Section 6 of the Human Rights Act. And whilst that might have been the most helpful way of trying to capture the acts of private authorities that are performing public functions at the time, the way it's been interpreted by the courts has now proved extremely unhelpful in knowing who is responsible for what at any time when public services are privatised. And for me, the major concern there is when children interact with any form of public service which has been outsourced to a private body, they ultimately may not have the human rights protection that they deserve. And there's different means of trying to address that gap. For example, using the more expansive definition it developed in further case law. I don't want to go through the full history of the cases, but if you go from YL to the Ali v Serco case in Scotland, you can see that the motivation of the private provider currently supersedes the protection of the rights of the right holder, and in this case it would be children, and that needs to be flipped, that the children's rights supersede the motivation of the private provider. And there may be different ways of achieving that aim, but if that's the aim of the bill, then that provision needs to be revisited, because the case law doesn't provide a helpful or a stable basis for private functions. And I feel like I've spoke at some length now. I didn't quite catch the end, the third part of the question, so I'm happy to come back to that, but I'm also aware that colleagues will want to come in on this, so I'll defer.
Okay,
can we go to Aileen now, please?
Thank you. I would agree with what Dr. Boyle has said there. In relation to Section 6, definition of public authority, as she says, this is based on the Human Rights Act. So I don't think there's any concern about children's hearings not being included. As far as I'm aware, children's hearings are regarded as a public authority for the purposes of the Human Rights Act. So that's not an issue. But as she says, it's the definition. And what is worth looking at here is the Victorian Charter of Human Rights. This is Australia. Sorry, the Victorian Charter.
Ms. McCarg, sorry, your sound totally dropped there. I wonder if we could ask broadcasting to cut the visual so that, and ask you to start your answer again so we hear you clearly.
Okay, so sorry. On Section 6, the definition of public authorities, I agree with Dr. Boyle that it's private providers carrying out functions on behalf of the state that is where there is real concern. And I would suggest a model that's worth looking at is the Victorian Charter of Fundamental Rights in Australia, which takes which was drafted with the problems of the Human Rights Act in mind, and makes it much more explicit that contracted out providers are to be included within the scope of the bill. So I think in order to prevent this bill being interpreted in the same way as the Human Rights Act, the drafting needs to change.
Thank you. And come to Kenneth now, please.
Thank you. I suppose my answer to all the questions that Mary Key asked is to ask you to remind yourselves that what this bill is designed to do is not just to give rights that are enforceable in a court of law, but also to change hearts and minds, to change the way that all of us in society, public and actually private authorities, courts, parents, teachers, whoever, in making decisions and particularly making policy decisions, put the children at the heart of that consideration. Now, I'm not saying children's rights are the eighth, they should be at the heart of the consideration. Now, if that is correct, then I think it follows that we need a broad range of sources to help interpret the specific provisions as we possibly can. We need as broad an interpretation of public authorities or bodies carrying out public functions as we possibly can in order to achieve a real change in the way that we as a society deal with children. And I hope you picked up the important point that Aileen McCarg made about children's hearings, which Mary Key mentioned. Mm-hmm. There's no question that a children's hearing is a public authority. Section 6.3A.2 says a court or tribunal is a public authority. There is no question that a children's hearing is a tribunal. So it's clearly included in as it stands.
Thank you. And Aileen, please.
Thank you. Again, one of the things about being last is I think I'm going to be using the word endorse quite a lot. Again, I would echo what Dr. Boyle said, and indeed what the other speakers have really, I think we're all on the same page here, that the more tools in the toolbox of interpretation, the better. It is at the discretion of the person doing the interpreting what they actually use and how much reliance they place on these things. That's not always true, certain kind of higher court decisions. But generally speaking, when we're looking more broadly at human rights sources, and particularly the work here of, for this, it'll be the work of the United Nations Committee on the Rights of the Child, as well as some other human rights bodies. Very important that the court has that in its mind when it's interpreting rights under the convention. So as far as Section 4 goes, I would definitely say that is important. One wee technical point that I don't think has been picked up, Section 4 referred to court, the sources the court is particularly referred to are the convention itself and the two optional protocols that have been ratified by the United Kingdom, the first two optional protocols. And it uses the word, it may take those things into account. I think I would be inclined to turn that into a must or a shall, the important distinction there, because it would seem odd when you're looking at convention rights if you didn't look at the convention itself and where relevant the optional protocol. That's really all I have to say on Section 4. Yes, keep the possibility of things used in interpretation as broad as possible. Now, moving to the Section 6 question, again, I would endorse everything said about private providers of public services, where things have been outsourced. I would agree with the other speakers, first of all, that the law, I don't think, has necessarily ended up where we thought it would, but it's very murky and it's unsatisfactory, and therefore we definitely need to look at that again in terms of private providers of public services. The other point I would raise there is, what about adding the Scottish Parliament to the list of bodies? That would seem to me to be a beneficial addition. So not just the Scottish ministers and a court or tribunal, but the Scottish Parliament. Mm. Okay, thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you. Mary, did you get everything you need there, or do you wish to come back in?
The only question that I think perhaps because my initial question was so long, the panel didn't particularly cover, was the issue of a public authority, what it should do if it is faced with secondary legislation which is in force but appears to be incompatible with the UNCRC requirements. If the panel could perhaps briefly touch on that, I'd appreciate that.
Katie, can I come to you, please?
I think perhaps I'll defer to my public law colleague, Professor McCarrick, on that one. In terms of there is an ability to be able to interpret in so far as possible, but I'll defer to Aileen in terms of responding to that.
Aileen, please.
Thank you. There is an interesting difference in Section 6 compared to the Human Rights Act. So the Human Rights Act gives public authorities a defence if they have no choice but to act in the way they did because of legislation that's in force. Mm-hmm. There is no such defence under this bill. And in that respect, it's modelled on the Scotland Act rather than the Human Rights Act. That creates quite an interesting potential anomaly whereby the Parliament retains the power to legislate contrary to the convention in future, but ministers don't have the power to act contrary to the convention. So there's a very interesting potential conflict there, which I think it would be worthwhile resolving.
Mm. Thank you. Do any other panel members wish to add anything to that? Professor Norrie, I see you speaking. We'll come to you.
From the private law perspective, Ailie McCarran has given the public law perspective. From the private law perspective, it seems to me that a public authority has to follow what the law says. It has to follow its duties under legislation, primary and secondary. And it's not for the public authority to make the decision that legislation is inconsistent with the UNCRC. That's a matter for the court. So I should have thought a public authority's safest action was to follow the law until such time as it was told that that law itself inconsistent.
Okay, thank you. Okay, and maybe if you're content, we'll move on to the next committee member. Fulton McGregor, please.
Hey, thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. Part two of the bill, as we know, envisages that the existing courts and tribunals will authorise the judicial remedies proposed in the bill rather than the creation of a new body. Do you think that these existing courts and tribunals are accessible to children and young people? And if you don't, can you suggest what improvements would be required here or with the bill more generally? I'm happy with any order, convener.
Okay. Katie, please.
Thanks very much. So the way that the remedies are set out in the Act is really what I would call sort of a high-level skeletal framework, which deals with what the court can do with legislation that's problematic. You know, so it can strike down retrospectively legislation that is incompatible under Section 20. It's the power to suspend those strike down powers under 25. It can also issue a declaration of incompatibility if, for example, it's legislation that's passed after this bill, which is incompatible and is not possible to interpret it, to interpret the subsequent legislation insofar as it's possible to do so as a compatible subsequent piece of legislation. So that's all about dealing with legislation. Under Section 8, you have this opportunity for courts and tribunals to issue remedies which they deem to be just and appropriate. So for me, this is where there is an emerging gap in terms of how to deal with what would be deemed effective remedies under international human rights law. And the UNCRC and the committee demands that if you're going to incorporate the treaty, you need to make redress available for unlawful acts. So those unlawful acts are not just the legislative provisions, but what happens if a decision maker doesn't comply with the legislation before it in a UNCRC compliant way. So how do children access effective remedies when something goes wrong, and not just in relation to those like big sort of skeletal acts? And actually, there's two things that need to be further fleshed out on the face of the bill. The first is that you need to introduce a children-friendly complaints administrative system. So the idea that if something does go wrong, the first point of call ideally would never be the court. You should exhaust other administrative mechanisms first, and those mechanisms need to be sensitive to children's needs. So that needs a sense almost a review of how that operates in practice, because these rights cut across all different areas, as you know see from the speakers here, all different areas of law. It's not just a family law issue, it's not just an immigration issue, it's not just an education issue. You know, it's about the provision of rights to children across different fields. You need to look at whether or not the administrative complaints system is child friendly. And again, that system of redress is something that the UNCRC implicitly requires. Second to that is, ultimately, in order for the UNCRC incorporation to work, you need to have also access to an effective remedy for a violation in a court. So a court always needs to be there as a means of last resort. And I think Section 8, the idea of the courts issuing remedies which they deem just and appropriate is something which we're very familiar with. It works in practice in other respects, but courts have to balance out many different things when they try and strike the balance of what is just and appropriate. And sometimes they'll be quite deferential in nature in relation to the remedies they provide, which is perfectly okay. The court has a whole list of different remedies it can use. But in other occasions for UNCRC violation issues, they may need to be more interventionist to help children out to actually access what a remedy which is effective, prompt, actually deals with the issue at hand. You know, the idea of using just damages alone will not suffice to meet children's needs. And so I would recommend that either a right and effective remedies on the bill, or that the courts have to strike the balance of ensuring just, effective and appropriate remedies. Thank you.
Thanks for that, Convener. Just before we bring the other panel members in, Dr Boyle helpfully actually preempted my second question. So I'm wondering if I can just say, in the interest of time, as you said at the start, if I could just suggest to the other three panel members, as well as answering the initial question, if, like Dr Boyle, they could also go on to talk about the remedies that could be provided by courts and tribunals and how effective they think they may be for children and young people in practice. Thanks.
Thank you. Aileen, please.
Thank you. So the remedies in the bill are again largely modelled on the Human Rights Act, but there are a couple of important differences. So one is in relation to time limits. I think that is very appropriately been extended so that time doesn't begin to run until a child reaches the age of 18. The other very important difference in terms of enforcement is the role of the Children and Young Persons Commissioner. They have the ability both to intervene in proceedings and to bring proceedings instead of relying on a child to do so. So I think that is a huge improvement in terms of enforceability. Courts themselves are, of course, public authorities in terms of this legislation, so they have to exercise their powers in a way that is compatible with the convention, and that might require them to take steps to improve or to change their procedures, improve accessibility, and so on and so forth. More generally, accessibility is a question of the availability of finance. It's also a question of knowledge of rights and obligations. And one thing that's missing from this bill, which is in the Welsh legislation incorporating the convention, is a duty to publicise and to make known the rights under the convention. So that might be something that's worth thinking about adding. So educative duties. I think that's all I've got to say.
Thank you. Kenneth, please.
Thank you. I should very much like to pick up on the point that Aileen has already said about the Children's Commissioner, Scotland's Commissioner for Children and Young People. To me, that office holds an absolutely central role into the effective implementation of legislation. But I think in order for the Commissioner to operate effectively for all children, and to ensure that they have the capacity to intervene when appropriate, we need a massive investment and a very big increase in the funding that office has, because I do think it's very central. And I say that for another reason. One of my fears about any concept of children's rights is its vulnerability to hijack. And what I mean by this is that very, very often children's rights are hijacked to serve adult interests. And the debate that perhaps goes to the court, and it's structured as if it were a children's rights issue, it's actually nothing to do with the child. It's adults arguing it out. And let me give two examples of that. There was a case a couple of years ago in England, a really interesting case in which a child thought under the Human Rights Act declaration that the rule, which also applies in Scotland, the rule that a sperm donor who is the father is not the father-in-law. And the child was arguing, that's an infringement of my right to family life. Now, there's an interesting argument to be had about where genetics fits into how we define parents. And that's how the court dealt with it. The child was three, and the child was arguing in court. Of course, the child wasn't arguing in court. What was really happening was that the adults were exploring an issue for adults. There's another example from Hungary, which is currently debating an amendment to their constitution to give the child the right to live in the gender identity it was born into. Now, just think about that for a moment. It had nothing to do with the right of the child always to retain the gender identity they were born into. It's the adult issue. Let's not have anything to do with gender recognition or gender reassignment or anything like that. So this is my fear, that children's rights issues are hijacked, and a very crucial protection is the role of Scotland's Commissioner for Children and Young People. So I would very, very much enhance that role. And there's powers in the Act to intervene. I'd like to see them much stronger.
Thank you. Eileen, please.
Thank you. I think if I can backtrack to where I think the question began, it was to do with how accessible the legal process is to children, if I understood it was Mr. McGregor's question properly. I think the bottom line is that the legal system is it is a system designed by adults for adults that in fact intimidates a lot of adults. And if you can see it as intimidating adults, how much more so is it going to be for a child? But from the child's perspective, I think our problem begins with the fact that many children don't know they have rights. If they've any concept of rights, they probably don't know much about them and they don't know what they are. And that goes right back to us not educating in schools about children's rights. And it is a constant frustration to me and a bit of a mystery as to why we don't have a compulsory aspect of the curriculum in all schools addressing children's rights from an early age. Now, the United Nations Committee on the Rights of the Child has lots of resources out there on its website and elsewhere to help design courses that would enable children from a very young age right through more sophisticated education to teenagers to explore children's rights. And I really think in Scotland we need to look at making that a mandatory part of the curriculum so that children grow up learning that they have rights and learning a bit about them and learning incrementally more and more about them. Now, in terms of embedding all of these things in the whole of Scottish society, I think the bill, and hopefully when it becomes an act, should be accompanied by some public education in terms of children's rights, because it's more than apparent that many adults in Scotland are not getting it on children's rights either. So on the education front, the first step to children having any hope of using the legal system is for them to understand what their rights are, to know that they have rights. And along with that goes the education of the adult community, not just the professionals who are discharging particular functions, not just school teachers and social workers, but including them in education that is perhaps tailored to their particular functions. But I would say education of the whole community on children's rights, because that's going to be an essential part of the puzzle in making it all coherent. But back to legal remedies, Absolutely, it's essential that the legal remedy should be there. Being able to go to court is the big stick that makes those under duties to do certain things remember ultimately that they have to do those things. So that has to be there in the background. But I would definitely want to see it as a last resort. Instead of that, what we need are things like child-friendly complaints procedures in all of the places that you find children. Wherever children are, a child-friendly complaints procedure, so that we're not looking at the idea of children having to even think of going to court. It's not going to get to that point. Another crucial part of all of this is advocacy service, someone to help the child pursue their rights. Now, many parents do that on behalf of children, but we have to remember that sometimes the source of the problem is the parent. So it can't all just be left to parents. Of course, there are children who are not living with their parents. So where the state is taking on the caring obligation, the child has to have the opportunity to raise issues there. If, however, the state is doing it, whether it's through foster care, residential care, the child's rights are not being respected. So in all of those places, we need complaints procedures, but we need the child to know that there's someone independent of that organisation who can help. Now, Professor Norrie highlighted the important role of the commissioner in that respect, and I completely endorse what he said there. There I go with that word endorse again. But there have to be other people in a position to do that as well. It can't all be left to the commissioner. So we have to look at a child advocacy service, developing that. Now, we've got that just starting up in respect of the children's hearing system, and perhaps that can be a model to take further. Other people having the opportunity to do that. And the final thing to mention here, I guess, is clarifying in the legislation just who can bring our actions, perhaps not simply an action in respect of a single child, but in respect of groups of children, a group interest, the sort of class action type approach to things. So there's a big role for adults in helping children pursue their rights. You can't just leave it to children alone, but a crucial part of that is making sure children know that they have rights and a bit about what they are.
Thank you. Katie is wanting to come back in, but before she does, I feel I'd totally endorse what you say about the point about education, but I think it would be remiss of me to not mention all the children and young people that the committee are coming across in our outreach work who are very switched on to their rights and have learned about their rights in quite innovative ways. We've had contact with the Children's Parliament, with Lickety Split Theatre, Who Cares Scotland, Aberlour, and there's lots of good work going on out there. So I think I would endorse your point, but I just want to acknowledge the children and young people that are doing that already and their supporters. Katie, you wanted to come back in.
Thank you. Yes, I just wanted to pick up on Professor Sutherland's point there about systemic issues and about the effectiveness of the current mechanisms that are used, relating back to the original question. The court already has within its power to issue different types of remedies. It can compel actors to do things. It can stop something from happening. It can quash a decision. There's the opportunity under this bill to issue damages. And often what we'll see is typical of human rights cases is that the remedy tends to fall in, the compensation sphere, which is not a bad thing. That can help with an effective remedy. However, some of the rights under this bill in relation to the treaty and in relation to international human rights law more broadly requires courts to adapt to new ways of dealing with systemic issues. I often use the example of the Napier case, which was a swapping out case where prisoners were swapping out in prisons. And when this case came before the court, the court found it was a violation of Article 3 of the European Convention of Human Rights. And the way the court responded to that was to issue damages to a lead case, and then all others behind that case could then seek damages too. Now, that was a systemic issue. There was a systemic problem in the prisons. And rather than actually issue an order for prison authorities to fix the problem, the way that the court responded to it, which was quite right within its sphere of competence, was to issue damages as a way of encouraging the government to change its behaviour. But under international human rights law, when you look at systemic issues when they arise, and they will arise in relation to, economic and social rights, you will often find that the issue is one of a collective nature, and it's not really appropriate to rely on this individual rights-based model of one person bringing a case, others, cases being assisted behind it, or under the new Group Proceedings Act, 2018 Act, looking at the individual rather than the collective systemic issue. So actually there is a lot more work to be done to think about how to issue what would be called structural orders, and this is something that's also been looked at in the court in respect of the National Task Force on Human Rights Leadership, where I also advise. And it's about trying to look at, when systemic issues, how should we respond legally to those issues. And so, for example, in other countries where you see this type of adjudication, what you might see is that the court will in some way group together cases where there's a systemic issue and issue a structural order, which may include asking different parts of government authorities, public authorities and possibly private authorities performing public functions to do different things in order to make or fix that original violation. And it's a new way of looking at these types of issues to deal with the initial problem, rather than relying on compensation to encourage better compliance. So it's just something to think about in terms of how we approach this. And of course, it's one of those things where there has to be an adaptation in how the judiciary operates. And theory and practice tells us that it's better to help the judiciary by explaining what's expected of them in a bill. So the more clarity and instructions you can give to help them in their duties, the better. And so perhaps there is, again, just room to refocus on what it is to be effective. What is the threshold for an effective remedy? And there is case law on this. The courts were used to doing that under EU law. We've now lost the right to an effective remedy under EU law as a result of Brexit. You have the right to have effective remedy under the ECHR, but again, it wasn't incorporated as part of the Human Rights Act. So there's a gap in provision there. And so the UNCRC bill presents an opportunity to address that gap for children.
Thank you. I'm going to go on to our next set of questions from Gillian Martin, please.
Thank you, convener. And I have a couple of questions which, in the interest of time, I'm going to run together in terms of who can bring court proceedings and the time limit on them as put in the draft bill. So, we've already discussed about the Children's Commissioner having the right to bring court proceedings. The Section 7 of the bill says an individual organisation can raise court proceedings in respect of an alleged breach of the duty in public authorities. But for the judicial review actions, it says that an individual organisation would also have to require to demonstrate, quote, sufficient interest to be able to bring proceedings. First of all, I want to ask you if you're happy with this overall approach and what your interpretation of what that would mean, and how do you assess that? And I'd also like to hear your views on whether it's correct to exclude the period when a young person is under 18 when calculating the time limits for raising court proceedings under Section 7 of the bill. We've had, in our submissions, we've had some quite mixed submissions and mixed views on this. So I'd be interested to know what our panel think.
OK, if I could go to Kenneth first, please.
Thank you. Could I take the point about excluding proceedings, excluding counting the time before the child has reached the age of 18? I think it has to have that. This is really a question of limitation and a question of how you have to raise proceedings if some wrong has been done to you. And it's entirely appropriate that you don't count time which a young person is under a particular age, because even although it goes back to Elaine Sutherland's point about education, children tend not to know what their rights are. You often don't understand that a wrong has been done to you until you're older and more mature. It would be very wrong to have the same period for a wrong done to a six-year-old as a wrong done to an adult, for example. And I think the reason for that is obvious. So I would endorse the provision as it stands. In terms of interest, I think it generally fits into the legal system as a whole that you have to be personally affected. Generally speaking, you have to be personally affected by an issue before you can raise that matter in court. I think there needs to be exceptions, and again, I come back to the Children's Commissioner. We shouldn't need to wait until harm is done. If a body like the Commissioner identifies a rule of law which has a real potential of doing harm, so I'd make exceptions to it. But I think the general principle that you have to be personally affected in itself is a good one.
Okay, I'm going to go to Elaine and then to Aileen. Elaine, please.
Yeah, first of all, the question about age, absolutely. Picking up on what I said in response to one of the earlier questions, that there are still issues about children knowing what their rights are. There's a big issue with non-lawyers identifying something as a legal problem. People very often in their lives know something wrong's happened to them, but they might not identify it as a legal problem. And then there are all the obstacles of even if a child did know that there was some legal wrong that had been done, finding someone to take the case, finding the right kind of solicitor, navigating through the legal system. And meanwhile, the clock would be running if we didn't have this provision that disregarded the period of time prior to the child being 18. So absolutely, I'm 100% behind that provision. Now, the objection that I have seen raised to it is, well, it could delay legal proceedings. And we're all very well aware that delay in legal proceedings involving children can be very harmful to the child. The time that it sometimes takes in courts, there are numerous occasions when the courts have raised that point. And indeed, the Children's Scotland Act just passed recently highlighted that delay in dealing with cases involving children is generally a bad thing. The courts should be aware of it. But all this provision does is give a child a benefit. It doesn't prevent the child bringing the case as soon as the child's aware that's a possibility. So the child can bring the case before the age of 18. It's just that the general time limit of 1 year in raising cases isn't going to apply to children until they reach the age of 18. So I'm very happy with that provision. I don't see the danger. I don't see why it's going to delay cases. But I think you'll be hearing in a later session this morning from at least one speaker who does believe that is the case. Now, the other question is who can bring proceedings? Yes. Yeah, I can see why it was a bit confusing the way the bill is drafted, because I don't think it's as clear as it could be on that point. Having an interest, well, you know, what does that mean exactly? There is a body of case law on that kind of thing, and as Professor Norrie pointed out, generally you have to have some personal interest in the case before you can bring it. You can't just bring some case on some abstract issue of injustice that happens to bother you. Now, the whole point about this bill is it did not adopt the victim test. And I think that's very important. It doesn't say you have to be a victim. It differs from other human rights provisions in that respect. And I think that was a very deliberate decision, and it was a result of a lot of lobbying at earlier stages, I think. But it still leaves a lot of ambiguity about the role of third parties bringing cases, class actions, as Dr. Boyle was explaining earlier, the great value of class actions as a way of having the rights of whole groups of people respected. So although the commissioner is specifically mentioned, and that's a good thing, I think there needs to be a bit more clarification on who can bring the action. Now, the policy memorandum does talk in terms of sufficient interest. It would be the usual test. My suggestion here is that it shouldn't be the usual test for who can bring cases. But in addition to the commissioner, there ought to be a formulation that would allow other bodies like non-governmental organisations to bring actions in respect to children's rights. So there would be a broader opportunity to challenge.
Thank you. Aileen, please.
Thank you. I think there is some misconception about what the sufficient interest test means in judicial reviews. The sufficient interest is a relatively new test that has been adopted, which has been interpreted very widely indeed. So it does not require a personal interest necessarily. It does allow what we call representative standing, so groups can bring actions on behalf of their members where their members are affected. It also allows what we call public interest standing. So if there is a general point of law or in the public interest that needs to be resolved, people can also make cases in that respect. So I think the key point is, as Professor Sutherland pointed out, this bill does not employ the victim test. Under the Human Rights Act, it is the victim test that has precluded those kind of representative and public interest cases. The absence of that victim test means that the normal rules of standing in public law cases will apply, in judicial review cases will apply, and that is now interpreted very widely. Thank you.
Thank you. Katie, can I bring you in now on the questions there around who can bring court proceedings and time limits for those proceedings, please?
Thank you. No, I actually don't have anything to add. Colleagues covered everything that I would say in that regard, so I'll leave it to move on.
Thank you. Gillian, can you give me a nod if you're satisfied, or do you need to come back in? You're happy. Okay. So we'll move along to Alexander Stewart now, please.
This is clear.
Alexander.
Thank you very much indeed, convener. Can I talk with reference to the part three of the bill, and it talks about the rights for children for the rights scheme, and also talks about the wellbeing impact assessment. So when we look at the provisions that are there for the children's rights scheme, it has been suggested that the language in the bill could be stronger. So it would be good to get your views on what you believe that is, if that is the case. And if there is anything that should be added to the content of that scheme. And my second question, as I say, talks about the wellbeing impact assessment, and that ministers have a legal duty with reference to the legislation and discussions about that. So with reference to that impact assessment, to what extent should ministers have discretion in relation to decisions of a strategic nature? Thank you, convener.
Thank you. Katie, please.
Thank you. Yes, I'll respond in relation to the scheme. And so far as Section 11, I mean, basically the idea of the scheme is to help ministers meet the obligations under the treaty, and there is a read down that, you know, the state obligations become obligations of ministers and public authorities And so the scheme is in a sense helping them to take the steps in order to demonstrate that they are meeting some of the obligations under the treaty, and it includes things like, for example, participation, awareness and promotion of rights and budget processes. Now, the way that that's phrased is that the scheme may take those things into consideration. And for some of the rights under the convention, that may be appropriate. But actually, in relation to, for example, some of the economic and social rights under the bill, there are other positive obligations that the state has. And so my concern would be that, the first of all, Section 11 is not an exhaustive list. And also, in relation to some rights under the convention, their obligations rather than discretionary things that can be taken into consideration. So I think broadening out an understanding of what the duties mean in practice will be helpful. There will be really important that supports rolled out for decision makers as well as ministers and parliament in understanding what the content of the rights mean and how to meet them in practice. And some of the other positive obligations, of course, include, for example, taking steps to realise rights, ensuring that the state has mechanisms in place to respect, protect, fulfil rights. Some rights have a minimum core option, which is a more immediately achievable level of right that has to be achieved. Basically, the children shouldn't fall below that level. But there's also progressive duties under international human rights law and under the convention, which relate to non-discrimination and provision of rights, that the state meets maximum available resources, which is a necessary component. So ensuring that resources are deployed in an effective, efficient, adequate and equitable way, those types of duties should fall under the scheme. Also ensuring that there's non-regression on rights, as well as ensuring that there's access to effective remedies. There are other types of duties under the treaty, and so the scheme itself perhaps could be clearer. Either you make sure that it's clear that that's not an exhaustive list, or you have further clarity with regard to those other obligations. And as I say, I'm not totally comfortable with the idea that these are discretionary rather than compulsory obligations.
Thank you. Aileen, can we come to you now on Alexander's questions there around the strength of language in the scheme and on children's rights and wellbeing impact assessments, please?
The only point I want to make here is the fact that these obligations only apply to the Scottish ministers. I think in the policy memorandum it says that other public authorities will be encouraged to do these things, but they're not obliged to do so. And I think that is, I think that's a gap. The obvious analogy for me here is with the Freedom of Information legislation, where all public authorities who are subject to that legislation have to draw up publication schemes. And that's a very important way of proactively ensuring transparency rather than relying on people to enforce their rights in an individual way. So I would like to see, I think, these things more broadly applicable. The difficulty, of course, would be around about the definition of public authority. There is, given that the Act does not, unlike the Freedom of Information legislation, specifically list the bodies who are covered by it, you would need to you'd need to define precisely which bodies are covered. But I would like to see a broader range of bodies included. On the impact assessment, certainly in relation to legislative proposals, I think that is, and it's, in case I don't get to say this later on, I think that's really important that when ministers are making compatibility statements, when they introduce legislation, that they have to reason their compatibility statements in terms of these impact assessments. That is a huge improvement on the Human Rights Act model, where reasons don't have to be given. Similarly, under the Scotland Act, I can see the case for making the binding obligation to draw up an impact assessment broader but I think you will get into definitional issues there. That's all I have to say. Thank you.
Thank you. Kenneth, please.
You know, I don't think I have anything more useful to add to what's already been said.
Okay, thank you. Elaine, do you have anything you wish to add on these matters?
Yeah, I do. I have a couple of terribly technical points. I think the first one, Dr. Boyle covered quite rather fully, and it's this difference between the must mm-hmm. and the may. Where you say the ministers in the children's rights scheme must do certain things as opposed to they may. And I think we're all very clear about the importance of that distinction. So I won't take up time going into too much detail there. The other little point is under the 2014 Act, the Children and Young People Scotland Act 2014, Section 1, that's where we got this first idea of the ministers having to report to the Scottish Parliament on what they were doing in respect of various aspects of children's rights. And one of the important bits was what were they doing to promote and strengthen children's rights out there. That provision required them to report every 3 years, and the Act gave a date for when the first report had to be lodged. It had to be within 3 years of the section coming into force. Now, that's going to go under this bill because there's going to be a new report and the Scottish ministers under the Children's Rights Scheme, and they're going hopefully be right, reporting about a lot more, and they're going to have to do it every year. So that's good. That's more frequent reporting, more accountability. But there's nothing in the bill that I can see that indicates when that first report has to be. So all the bill says is that the ministers must indicate, as I recall, they must indicate in the scheme when their first report's going to be. So they have to report, indicate under the scheme, but it's still entirely at their discretion when that first report has to be produced. Now, they could, under the scheme, decide they're going to have their first report 5 years down the road, longer than under the 2014 Act. Thereafter, they'd have to report every year, but there's nothing triggering the whole thing, activating the whole thing at this stage. So I think we need to look at the 2014 Act and a parallel provision that the report must be within 1 year of the section coming into force. Now, that brings up a problem, an issue that's completely off a tangent, but I really would like to raise it just now because I'd be afraid of not getting it in at some point. And that's this business of ministerial discretion about when things happen. And that raises the whole point about Section 40 of the bill. When is the Act going to come into force, assuming it passes? Now, that is left, again, entirely to ministerial discretion. So although it's not actually to do with the Children's Rights Scheme, it's another aspect of ministerial discretion, which seems to be a flaw, I think, that maybe is there permeating what is an otherwise, in many respects, very good statute. Too much ministerial discretion on when they have to do their first report, when the Act would come into force itself. So, what have I got left here? I'm not sure that I have anything to add on the impact assessments, save to say, again, there's an issue of too much ministerial discretion. In terms of the ministers must prepare one in relation to such decisions of a strategic nature relating to the rights and well-being of children as they consider appropriate. Again, it's another example of that huge ministerial discretion. And I think I'd like to see, again, that reined in a bit.
Thank you. That's very helpful. I'm going to bring Katie back in for some succinct comments that she wishes to add to her previous remarks. Katie.
Just to say that the Child's Rights Scheme, the reporting procedures and impact assessments help decision makers and duty bearers comply with their obligations, but they do not dispense with those obligations. So regardless of whether or not those mechanisms were in place, there are causative duties that duty bearers need to take. And so, you know, this is just a means to help with implementation. It does not absolve those duty bearers of other obligations. They actually have to take positive steps. And I think that's where Professor McCarge really highlighted a big issue around the public authority, because Parliament is not included within that definition, and Parliament has obligations in relation to the treaty, which are not actually in the bill itself. The administrative sphere of decision making, including public authorities, need to go further than just reporting. They actually need to take positive steps to fulfil rights. And I think that's perhaps where there's a little bit more scope to explore what that means in practice and to help them with that obligation.
Thank you. That's helpful. Alexander, do you have any supplementary questions, or are you content to move on?
No, I'm content with the information that's been given this morning. Thank you.
Okay. Alex, we can come to you now, please.
Thank you very much, Convener. Good morning to our panel. I have a couple of questions. The UNCRC is two things principally. Firstly, it's an international baseline, which the United Nations sets as being the standard for children's rights, for which it says it will accept nothing wants states to go further. And I think that Article 28 is a good example of where the UK and Scotland does better than the UNCRC in terms of child soldiering. We don't allow soldiers, child soldiering before the age of 16, where the baseline is 15. But we're behind on things like the age of criminal responsibility. UNCRC wants to be 14, we have it set as 12. It's not actually implemented there. So my first question on that is, do you think that there is an imperative for Scotland to get to the floor on all levels to sort of morally claim to have fully incorporated the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child?
Thank you. Katie.
I'm so sorry, I missed the tail end of the question. I wonder if the member could repeat, please. Sorry.
Happy to. I'm just saying, do you think that there is a moral imperative for Scotland to get to the baseline level on all of the articles and all of the general commons for us to morally conclude that we have incorporated the UNCRC into Scots law?
Thank you very much. Well, I would say, you know, the moral imperative is really a policy matter rather than a legal matter. But if I speak on legal terms, there's a legal imperative. Whether or not it's enforceable in law is a different thing. But the UK signed up to the treaty, so as an absolute minimum, it has a legal obligation to meet the standards set in the treaty, and they are minimum standards. And of course, it's great if states can go beyond that. You know, it really just sets a framework for a minimum standard. It is a legal obligation. What this bill does is try to facilitate an enforceable legal obligation, whereas without incorporation, that wouldn't exist. And in those parts of the treaties that are redacted because of the devolved reserved, and I think. For example, the recruitment of soldiers as part of that redaction, if I remember correctly, you know, it's always about within so far as it is possible to do so, Scotland and everyone exercising public authority on behalf of Scottish bodies, whether that be the Parliament, the government, public authorities or private authorities performing public functions, should all be seeking to comply with the standards, even those that, for example, have been redacted for the purposes of devolved competence.
Thank you. Aileen, can I ask, bring you in, please?
I don't have a particular view on this. All I would say, Katie is right to say that there are issues of divided competence here. I would also just point out that the Parliament is not under any sort of legal obligation as a matter of domestic law to implement the Convention. the state is under an obligation as a matter of international law to comply with the convention. That's all I have to say. Thank you.
Thank you. Kenneth, would you have anything you wish to say?
Yeah, there's 2 points I want to make in answer to that important question. The first thing is that the single greatest argument in favour of incorporating the UNCRC is that it turns an international obligation into a domestic legal obligation. And that gives it more force, because an international obligation, even although international law is law, politics can get in the way, and governments and states can decide, well, international law doesn't apply to us, and there's no enforcement mechanism. So it is that is the single greatest argument in favour of incorporating, that it turns this moral imperative into a legal imperative. The second point I want to make, Alex Gill-Hamilton mentioned quite rightly that the convention sets minimum standards. And there's a provision in the convention itself, and it's in the schedule to the Act, it's Article 41, which permits states to go further. I have a suggestion to make, and it is to enhance Article 41 somewhere in the body of the bill. Because I think, and this sort of gets back to my original point, the point I made some time ago, that I fear parents and others will hijack children's rights in order to actually limit children's rights by arguing this is a children's right not to be brought up in a particular way, not to be exposed to literature that shows an LGBT lifestyle is a legitimate lifestyle. These sorts of things, arguments are used to limit children's rights. Now, we need to have something in the Act that protects protects us against that. Article 41 helps to some extent, but I don't think it goes quite far enough. What I would like is some equivalent to Section 13 in the Human Rights Act 1998. Because that says something like, courts have to pay particular regard to the importance of Article 9 of the ECHR. I should like an amendment into this bill saying the courts should pay particular regard to the importance of Article 41 of the UNCRC. And that will encourage courts, bring it immediately to their attention, that this is a minimum standard thing and ought not to be used in a way that deals with an adult agenda but actually limits the rights of children.
Thank you. Elaine, please.
I would agree that, of course, the strength in this bill and the reason it should be supported is it is taking that state obligation and bringing it into Scots law. A kind of parallel with the Human Rights Act, making it very important. But I think another benefit of the bill is that hopefully it's going to generate conversations out there in the community, conversations in Parliament, in the community, in schools, wherever you find children, about children's rights. And in doing that, it'll raise the profile and the understanding of children's rights. I'm getting back to this idea. It's not enough to have this stuff in legislation and think we're done. We need to make it work. So there needs to be the practice following through. And of course, the bill contains mechanisms to try and make sure that happens. But we also need to be embedding it in the community so that people are understanding. It's back to the sort of point I made before. In terms of satisfying the minimum requirements of the convention, yes, in my view, Scots law should be trying to achieve that, but frequently it should be trying to go further. Now, I think my answer to my very first question was about the examples of cases where we have gone further and how that's fine. These things are beneficial. I think we should see what the convention is asking us to do or telling the state to do as a minimum sort of threshold, going beyond that where possible and where appropriate.
Thank you. Alex.
Thank you, Convener. I have another part to that question, and then one final quick follow-up question, if you can bring me back in. So I said that the UNCRC was two things, and that is the baseline, and then the second thing is it's a living document. There is obviously the articles that are enshrined under the convention itself, but alongside those are three other organic things, and those are the optional protocols, the general comments, and the concluding observations from the rapporteur when the rapporteur comes to visit our country. Are the panel content that there is sufficiency within this bill to allow government to reflect on those three organic arms of the convention so that it makes the UNCRC a living document in Scotland when we've incorporated it?
Do you have anyone in particular you want to direct that to, Alex? Professor Norrie, okay.
Thank you. I think you're absolutely right. I think it is really important that governments and courts and public bodies are directed to as many of the official documents, the official working papers as is possible, because that is the only way that we can identify appropriate trends, we can identify appropriate gaps in the provision, and then bring them properly into force in a practical, meaningful sense in Scotland. So yeah, I would absolutely agree with that.
Thank you. Aileen, would you wish to come in on Alex's question there?
No, thanks.
Okay. Does anybody else want to come in on that? I'll move to my final question.
Aileen wishes to come in. Aileen, yes, please.
Yes, I'm live. One thought when absolutely I would endorse we want government looking at all of these things and being as informed as possible about what the United Nations Committee is telling us. The sad truth is, as far as optional Protocol 3 is concerned, the UK has not ratified it. It doesn't look like it's in any rush to do so. And there's just nothing we can do in Scotland to do that. I mean, it's a matter for the state party whether it ratifies an optional protocol. For the benefit of any committee members who may be not clear, the optional Protocol 3 is about what's called in United Nations speak a communications procedure. It's really about complaints over violations of the convention, and we have not ratified that. And as I say, Scotland has no power to do that, so we're a bit hamstrung on that one. That's my only comment.
Thank you. Katie wishes to come in, and then we'll come back to Alex for his other question. Katie.
Thank you, Alex. I think the question succinctly identifies a gap, and that gap can be addressed by an amendment to Section 4, insofar as interpretation requires to be with regard to UN treaties, treaty body decisions, optional protocols, general comments, recommendations and comparative law. And I would just reiterate what I said earlier about the example from South Africa, where there is a duty to, well, you must have regard to international law and may have regard to comparative law as a useful example to draw on. And it's also not dissimilar to Section 2 of the Human Rights Act about that the courts must have regard and interpretation to ECHR jurisprudence. So it's just about ensuring that when the interpretation occurs, it occurs in context. Otherwise, it won't work. We'll end up with a UNCRC version, Scottish version, without necessarily interpreting it in its context, which is international human rights law.
Thank you. Alex, please.
Thank you. Thank you for those answers. My final question is about commencement. It's one thing to pass an act, but it's another thing to commence it. We're now nearly 2 years since we passed the age of criminal responsibility Act in the Scottish Parliament, and our ACR is still 8. We've still not made it 12 yet. Not clear why that is. But I just wondered, the commencement section in section 40, commencement of the Act leaves it up to ministers when they shall determine this will come into force. Firstly, are the panel content with that? And can they point to any barriers or impediments which would create an unnecessary delay in commencing the provisions of this Act? That's all panel members.
Okay. We will go to Katie first then, please.
Thank you. I think commencement is a policy decision, so I don't have a legal response to it other than to say that ideally it would be without delay. I think in other countries such as Sweden, for example, they have had a run-in period to allow those who will bear obligations under the Incorporation Act there to have time to kind of catch up. My concern would be that, you know, since 2014, there's already been obligations to be aware of what the duties are under UNCRC. So ideally, you know, you would commence without delay, and really that ultimately is a policy decision.
Thank you. Aileen.
Yeah, thanks. I mean, there are provisions on the statute book which have been languishing unimplemented for a lot longer than 2 years. So clearly, this is an issue at times. The argument for a delay in commencement would be to allow public authorities to get up to speed with the obligations under the Act. So in all of the big changes in public sector duties that we've seen over the past 20 years, there has been a delay. There was a sort of year or so for the Human Rights Act. There was 3 years for the Scottish Freedom of Information legislation, 5 years for the UK Freedom of Information legislation. If we go right back to the Equal Pay Act, there was a 5-year delay implementation of that. So I think it is reasonable. If you were concerned, the obvious thing to do would be to set a date by which particular provisions must be brought into force. But I think it would be reasonable to give a fairly substantial period to allow for that implementation, to allow proper compliance with the legislation. Thank you.
Kenneth, please.
All I would say is that I would prefer a specific date rather than leaving it to ministerial discretion. A specific date and focuses people's minds, and not after royal assent, but a reasonable and reasonably short period should be allowed.
Thank you. Aileen, do you wish to comment on that question?
Well, I raised this earlier, the idea of not liking the discretion that was left there. I would go with understand public authorities need to take on board what they've got to do, but they have been aware of the Convention on the Rights of the Child since 2014, since that legislation, and well before then. So this isn't coming out of the blue to them. I think a period perhaps, but a very short one, and sort of specifying in the Act itself that within a period of time after royal assent, not leaving it to the discretion of the ministers.
Thank you. That draws our first session this morning to a close. Can I thank Dr. Boyle, Professor McCarg, Professor Norrie and Professor Sutherland. I appreciate you joining us so early this morning and the perseverance with some of our technical difficulties. If there was anything that you wish to share that you didn't feel you get the opportunity to, please do correspond with the committee, and likewise we may follow up with you. So thank you very much this morning. We're now going to suspend to allow the second panel to be set up, and we'll reconvene at 10 past. Thank you. Welcome back and good morning to our second panel, Morag Driscoll, Child and Family Law Subcommittee, Law Society of Scotland, Janice Scott QC, Faculty of Advocates, Andy Sorrell, Scottish Refugee and Migrant Centre, Just Rights Scotland, and Professor Kay Tisdall, Professor of Childhood Policy, University of Edinburgh. Thank you all for joining us this morning. If I may quickly repeat how the session will continue, I'll invite members to ask questions. If a question is directed to a specific witness, the member will identify that witness. Otherwise, we'll work through the order that witnesses appear on the agenda. We need to conclude this session by no later than 11:45. So if we can try to keep questions and answers succinct, that's helpful. And there is no need to touch your microphones or camera. Broadcasting will do that all for you. So with all that said, if we can begin the questions. There's strong support for direct incorporation of the NCRC into Scots law. Can I ask panel members for their views on the approach that the Scottish Government's taken? I'm particularly interested to hear what you feel the benefits are and if there are any disadvantages of this approach. And if I could go to Morag first, please.
Thank you very much for inviting me today. The Law Society is very much in support of this bill and the incorporation of children more accessible and better recognised in Scotland. Can you hear me all right?
Morag, yeah, you are coming through. It's crackling a little bit, so I'll just ask broadcasting that if that continues to happen, that they cut your video so we can hear you nice and clearly. But do continue, please.
No, that was all I had to say. Was the society does welcome the bill.
Okay, and do you see any disadvantages in the approach that's being taken, or?
Well, I listened to the previous session. And to use Elaine Sutherland's words, I would endorse the comments that were made in that session. And I don't feel I can answer this in great detail at this stage. So I would pass this one on to Janice.
Okay. Janice, if we could bring you in, please.
Thank you very much. On behalf of the faculty, we do welcome the opportunity to give evidence in relation to the bill. The faculty very much respects the rights of the Parliament to set its policy in relation to incorporation. And in response to the question of benefits or disadvantages, I think I would frame this in terms of challenges, because you're setting practitioners the challenge of dealing with what is an aspirational convention and translating that into rights in individual cases. It's helpful, I think, that the Parliament has chosen or is choosing to follow an established pattern in terms of the Human Rights Act. And if I can just give you one example of that, one thing that hasn't been mentioned by my academic colleagues, in section 19 of your current bill, you adopt the model from the Human Rights Act that, so far as possible to do so, legislation is to be read and given effect in a way that is compatible with UNCRC requirements. And what that is going to enable us to do is to face the challenge that you have posed us by, if appropriate, reading down your legislation. That's a very powerful thing that you've put in the hands of the courts, because it means that we, or the courts, can take a red pen or can read in passages to legislation which will enable the UNCRC requirements to be better met.
Thank you. Andy, please.
Yes, good morning. Thank you, convener and members of the committee, for inviting me along today. On behalf of Just Rights Scotland, we welcome the bill. We believe it is an extremely strong bill, notwithstanding some recommendations that we will that we've made in our written evidence and will go on to make today. In terms of the broad approach, the maximalist approach, we are in favour of it. In particular, we appreciate the distinct proactive and reactive elements to the bill. The upstream measures looking at the children's rights scheme, looking at the impact assessments. These, in our opinion, are really, really important because they will, I hope, help policymaking and lawmaking obtain compliance at an initial stage, and it will help things being ironed out before it comes into force. As a litigator, who represents children, I don't want to go to court for children. If we can avoid that at all costs, that's what we want to do. But it's great having that upstream dynamic. However, you need the downstream, the reactive measures. You need enforceability, and the bill is very strong in that. It's using familiar language to us as human rights practitioners. It's using remedies that we have used before, albeit in perhaps in slightly different ways. It creates positive changes to some of the existing things that we use, you know, issues around standing, issues around time limits, which I'd like to speak about later. It changes things dramatically. It allows me, for example, to go into a court and say to a judge, this is a violation of UNCRC. This bill, before this bill came through or before the Act comes into force, the judge will say, well, that's very well, thank you, Mr. Thurl, but I can't do anything about that. After this bill, they will. And that, for me, is it in a nutshell. We welcome it.
Okay, thank you. Kay, please.
No, and just to check, are you able to hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Thank you. Well, as you will have seen by our evidence, we think it's absolutely wonderful to have the bill and only want it to be strengthened through the process. And I think example of that, we recently, as the Observatory of Children's Human Rights Scotland, were commissioned by the Children's Commissioner, I think you know, to do the independent CREA. I believe it's been submitted to the committee. But I think that underlined that taking a children's rights approach makes better policy and we hope better practice. Because doing that independent CREA did point out in times of crisis that there were issues that were not paid sufficient attention to, from schools being open to provisions for children affected by domestic abuse. And that very CREA experience, that focus on children's rights, drew our attention to that and are leading us to actually really making those real differences that we heard were really important to children.
Thank you.
So often stronger.
Thank you. Mary Fee, please.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. There are two areas I would like to explore with the panel this morning. And the first is in relation to Section 4 and the interpretation of the UNCRC requirements. And I'd be keen to hear whether the panel think it should be expanded to take account of general comments or concluding observations. And if that was to happen, do the panel think there are any unintended consequences if this was done? And my second question is in relation to public authorities. And for panel members that listened to the previous session, you'll know that I asked the previous panel if they think that the definition of a public authority should be expanded to take into account every organisation that has contact with a child, whether it's a private organisation, a third sector organisation, or the children's hearing system. And I'd be particularly keen to hear the Faculty of Advocates' view on children's hearings, because it was the faculty's evidence that raised questions or queried whether or not the children's hearing system would be included. And my final question in relation to public authorities was what a public authority should do if it is faced with secondary legislation which is incompatible with the requirements under the UNCRC, and I'd be grateful for the panel's views on that.
Okay, you mentioned the Faculty of Advocates there, so we'll go to Janice first, please.
I can deal first of all with the issue of general comments. Mm-hmm. These are helpful as interpretive instruments. It's useful to a court to have all the assistance it can in interpreting a particular piece of legislation, just so long as these are not determinative, because it would be difficult and one probably shouldn't want to have an external body to dictate to Scottish bodies what they should do. So helpful, yes. Determinative, no. So take account by all means, but take account within the domestic context. In terms of public authorities, I think Kenneth is absolutely right. A children's hearing is a public authority. And I'm trying to find where the faculty mentioned tribunals. I don't think it was quite in that particular context. So I'll come back to it, if I may, and perhaps write to you about that. But I don't think that was the context in which it was mentioned. I think one of the points which arose in the academic discussion was, what do you do about private organisations exercising public functions on behalf of public authorities? Mm-hmm. And it is important to clarify that if a private organisation is exercising a public function, they are to be treated as a public authority. That is vital in terms of the operation of this piece of legislation. I hope that covers the points.
Yes.
Thank you. I'll go to other panel members now for any comments on Mary's questions there. Morag, if we could come to you first, please.
I am in full agreement with Janice. And as Elaine said earlier, the more tools you have, the better. But again, they should not be determinative, but available to the court to assist in the understanding of the meaning of the UNCRC, which is, of course, a flexible document, and general comments come out. We'd be ignoring a valuable resource if we didn't include those. Yes, I also agree. Private organisations carrying out functions, the best illustration of this are the services which will be providing advocacy for children in children's hearings. If they're carrying out, in effect, a public function, they should be obliged, as public organisations are. We'd be ignoring the people that are actually at the coalface.
Thank you. Andy, can I come to you now, please?
Yes, so first of all, with respect to Section 4 interpretation of UNCRC requirements, I agree with Morag and with Janice. And actually, it speaks to a question that Alex Cole-Hamilton asked on the previous panel, and it's talking about the Convention as a living instrument. A living instrument means that the document, the scope of the rights developed gradually as time goes by in alignment with societal attitudes. This is a well-known autonomous concept within international human rights law. It's applied in the context of the European Court of Human Rights. Policy memorandum to the bill emphasises at paragraph 144 that the rights on the face of the bill remain within their context. They must be looked at within their context of the whole of the UNCRC and the optional protocols. Context is important there. In the context of the European Convention on Human Rights and the Human Rights Act, our courts have a requirement under Section 2 of the Human Rights Act to take account of judgments from the Strasbourg Court, the European Court of Human Rights. Whether it's against the UK or a case against Hungary or a case against Azerbaijan, those cases must be taken into account. They're not determinative, but they must be taken into account. We do not have that equivalent on the face of this bill. We do not have an equivalent of the European Court of Human Rights, really, in the context of the UNCRC. What we do have is concluding observations, general comments, and other interpretive sources, and that's why I think that they are important and they should be included on the face of the bill, because it allows our courts to look to those things to see a modern manifestation of what the rights look like now and apply that in our Scottish context. I agree with Janice, not determinative, but a source of inspiration. With respect to Section 6, public authorities, this is an issue that I have sympathy with the drafters of the bill. I appreciate the context. I appreciate the intention behind keeping the wording as broad as possible. I agree with what the policy memorandum says behind the intention. I worry about how it would work in practice. And I know that there were references in the memorandum to you know, a long history of litigation around what is a public authority. That long history has not left us in a settled. Just last year, we had the inner house and the outer house of the Court of Session coming to, you know, complete disagreement on really the fundamental test that should be applied here. They had differences of interpretation of the test. So if after 20 years of litigation, we still have Scottish courts dealing with each other on the same set of facts, then that is problematic. So I think that it might be helpful for the committee to look to other sources of inspiration. I see that in the evidence submitted by the Human Rights Commission, Scottish Human Rights Commission, there was a very detailed assessment of this, and in our evidence as well. The Joint Committee on Human Rights down south has looked at this issue twice. They've actually suggested wording. There's wording there that I like, talking about referring to a contract or other arrangement with a public authority, which is under a duty to perform the function. The problem is this: if we don't have something more specific and we leave it to a slightly inconsistent or unclear approach in the courts, then it leaves us with a lack of certainty as to who is under the duties and when. And that is not a very good place to be. We want local authorities to be certain about what they're doing in terms of their corporate procurement. We want private parties to be certain about what obligations are on them when they enter into a procurement exercise with a local authority. And we want children and young people and families to understand when they are able to access their rights in what circumstances. And in children's rights in particular, in the children's sphere in Scotland, you know, you have private foster care placements, private care homes. You have social work functions, aftercare functions that are completely outsourced to charities. You know, so this is we have mixed models there. And I think that leaving it to the judicial interpretation hasn't got us into a very good place. So perhaps some additional wording in the bill around this would be useful.
Thank you. Kate, do you have any comments you wish to add?
Yes, just to address the first two parts of the question. As you will know by our evidence, we do think we would advise the courts to have a due regard duty to the general comments, the concluding observations, and the decisions from the option three protocol. And we think that's really strong. An example is we were making suggestions in terms of the Children's Scotland Bill that recently went through with the family law. Looking at the general comment on Article 12 was incredibly useful in terms of the discussions to realise that children's capacity should not be a threshold for their views to be considered. So I think that shows the value of doing it, and a due regard seems an appropriate balance for the courts. And as you will know, we actually think that also should be applied to the children's rights scheme and as well to children's rights impact assessments. Secondly, the public authority issue seems to be very serious, as Andy has just documented, and I think that's really important to try to make sure that is firm in terms of this legislation. It is clear that a lot of children's lives are affected by private organisations that are carrying out arguably public functions, from childcare, housing, residential care. So I think this is a key issue. That we need to follow the intention of the Scottish Government and make sure it's clear. Thanks.
Thank you. Mary, do you have any follow-up, or are you content that you...
No, thank you, Convener. I'm content. I mean, I'm very grateful for the comments around definition of public authority, and it is something we'll be taking much more evidence on, and we'll give very careful consideration to that. So I'm grateful to the panel's comments.
Okay, thank you. Now, with Fulton's permission, I am going to bring in Gillian Martin next. She's unable to stay for the whole session. So Gillian Martin and then Fulton McGregor, please, Gillian.
Thank you, Convener. Very grateful you were able to bring me in early. As the panel, Section 7 of the Bill says an individual or an organisation raised court proceedings in respect of an alleged breach of the duty of public authorities, and it specifically empowers the Children's Commissioner to raise proceedings. For judicial review actions, the government's policy intention is that any individual or organisation would require to demonstrate, quote, sufficient interest to be able to bring such proceedings. I'm interested to know how you interpret that, if it's clear enough what the sufficient interest is, and if you're happy with the overall approach in terms of how the government policy intention is giving effect to sections 7 and 10 in the bill. And supplementary to that, I'm going to ask my timing question as well, because we have had mixed submissions on this. The idea that is it, whether it's correct to exclude the period when a young person is under 18 in calculating the time limits for raising courts proceedings under Section 7 of the bill. So I'd like to know all your individual opinions on when court proceedings can be initiated.
Thank you. If we could go to Morag first, please.
Oh, this is complex stuff, as we've heard earlier today. It would be unfair to treat a child in the same way as an adult when it comes to time limits. There are also concerns that if potentially somebody could be waiting 10, 15 years to bring something, but that is slightly inevitable. But I would suggest that it is entirely appropriate to keep the time limit children. There are some practical issues in the operation of Section 7 because of the potential for delay. Early action children, 6 months in the life of a child is like 3 years for an adult. So delay must be avoided, but that remedy must be retained. And it is, of course, discretionary. It's case by case. So I think it's important the courts retain that discretion. The Children's Commissioner is the logical person to do this, but I would agree with the earlier session talking about potential for class action. We don't want the problem of adults using this to export issues that are really for adults, but there will be times when it becomes apparent that there is a problem and perhaps an organization, a charity that deals with this would wish to raise an issue on behalf of the children affected by that issue or children throughout Scotland. But again, it's a matter in many ways for the courts to say whether or not this is acceptable. And perhaps there could be provision for discretion or some guidance, but I think I'd rather leave that aspect to Janice, who would actually be the sort of person doing it.
Okay. On that, we'll bring in Janice right now.
Janice. Thank you very much, Marina. In relation to the Children and Young Persons Scotland Commissioner, that is a most welcome provision. When I was giving an opinion on the equal treatment issue, I was conscious that the Commissioner in Northern Ireland tried to challenge a similar deficit in Northern Ireland law, had been knocked out on lack of interest. And it was an appalling prospect that one had to wait for a child victim before one could actually challenge something that was deficient in terms of children's rights. So to allow the Commissioner to be proactive on that point is going to be hugely important in the implementation of your bill and the recognition of children's rights in Scotland. In terms of sufficient interest, the courts, as you appreciate, now interpret that very broadly. And it's a question of striking a balance between not permitting a busybody action or somebody that doesn't have a direct interest raising proceedings and somebody who does have an interest in intervening in proceedings and assisting the court in reaching a decision. So that's a balance to be struck in relation to instigation and intervention. In relation to the timing issue, I think is principally my issue. The problem is this. One has to look at what remedy one is asking for. If one's asking for a judicial review remedy, one is saying that a decision has been reached by a public authority that is unlawful. And therefore, it requires to be addressed, to be struck down. An order requires to be given saying, don't do that or please do that. And if you're looking for the addressing of an unlawful decision, it's no good waiting 10 years because you want it there and then. And if you wait 10 years, it's going to be entirely academic because the whole point will be lost. It'll be lost for the child. It'll be lost for the public authority. And it will not be conducive to good administration or proper recognition of children's rights to say we can bring up this stale case 10 years later when the whole point is gone. So if it's a judicial review remedy, there is not much point, frankly, in saying that a child can bring this up 10, 15 years later, or it could be brought up on behalf of the child 10 or 15 years later. Damages are a different issue because you might want to say, well, this child suffered wrong 10 years ago. It hasn't been properly recognised. We can now recognise that in damages. And I can see that. On the other hand, if you look at, I think it's the Essex case in the Supreme Court, there was reasoning there that said, look, we're not going to allow this to be brought up after the end of the year because the amount involved is going to be quite small and it's going to be disproportionate to require a public authority to go back many, many years later, potentially, and to look at the damages question. So in relation to judicial review, I think the answer is pretty clear. Matters ought to be dealt with quickly. And there's no point in extending it. In relation to damages, I think there's a proportionality issue to be addressed. And you might want to look at that in terms of permitting the court to hear a late claim if it's considered appropriate. But leaving it open in this way, it is potentially going to cause problems and rather more problems than it will address.
Thank you. Andy, if we can come to you now on those points from Gillian on who can bring court proceedings and time limits, please.
Sure. Thank you. So with respect to the first question on sufficient interest, I like this part of the bill. I like that the victim test, which you find in the Human Rights Act, has not been included. This is a significant widening of access to justice. In terms of sufficient interest, I hear what you're saying about what does it mean. As a lawyer, I'm not particularly vexed by that issue at this moment in time because, as Janice has said, and as I think Aileen McHard said on the previous panel, the courts through ACSA and momentarily forget Walton and Scottish ministers. The courts have interpreted this pretty widely, to be honest with you. And I feel as a lawyer, we have, you know, a good sense of what interest means in practice. So I'm not particularly vexed about it. Where I do have a slight concern is the more broad discussion that's going on UK-wide right now, emanating from the UK government about, you know, looking at judicial review and standing and who can take cases. I have a slight concern about the direction in which that's going, which may well look to narrow down sufficient interest, and this could play out further in the courts. I'm not sure what we can do about that. Perhaps a means of moving this forward in this bill is actually including the word sufficient interest in the bill. That might be helpful. But again, if scope narrows in the courts, then, you know, that doesn't take as much further. So I do have a slight concern about that. But at this moment in time, sufficient interest is good. It is a significant move forward that a child doesn't need. A very quick example, I'm working with a young person just now. He's an asylum-seeking young person, first into adult accommodation in a hotel in Glasgow this summer, in terrible condition. Colleagues and I were looking at the prospect of bringing a case to challenge the action of holding asylum seekers, never mind young people, hell accommodation with no money. My client, though, was undergoing numerous different types of legal process at that point in time, age assessment, asylum process, etc. And he was very, very unwell and suffering trauma. He wasn't in a place, really, to even have capacity to instruct me to take another case challenging his accommodation. If we didn't have the victim test, then perhaps my organisation or another organisation would be able to take that case on his behalf. That's the difference. It's substantial. With respect to the time limits, and I say this with great trepidation, I probably will depart from Janice's view on this point. It's not often I do that, but I'll have to do that here. There are two broad reasons why I am in agreement with what is in the bill in respect of Section 7 time limits. First one, Professor Norrie actually flagged in the earlier panel. It takes into account the evolving capacity and maturity of children and young people as they get older, allowing them to have a say as regards acts done to them when they were too young to take any action themselves. Fundamental aspect, access to jump. That's the first very basic point. The second point, though, speaks to the balance of power. I think we need to bear that in mind and remember it. The balance of power most definitely favours public authorities, corporate agents, not the child. There's, of course, a requirement for a level of certainty to facilitate good governance. I believe the bill does not place an onerous burden on public authorities, especially when considered next to the onerous burden placed on children to meet strict time limits. I think I can't recall who it was on the previous panel, but they described the legal justice system in this country as designed for adults by adults. And that's true. To give you a practical example from our own recent experience, and this is not unique, I could regale you with these examples all day, I'm afraid. Child having escaped cannabis cultivation, living in adult accommodation, age assessed by local authorities being over 18, the assessment outcome verbally communicated to them through an interpreter. So the person knew the outcome of the assessment, didn't quite grasp the reasoning, and they were not provided a written report, for another 4 weeks. This young person has no experience of living in Scotland, no money, no English language, no education, no social worker, limited practical support, and serious trauma. They were at a continued risk of re-trafficking. When they referred to my service and we attempted to challenge the assessment in question, the local authority fought hard to knock the case out on the basis of it being submitted out with the 3-month time limit in their interpretation of the time limit. And the court applied the law and noted that the time started running from the date that he was told of the decision orally, not from the date that it was written to him. And that is an application of the law. In the specific parts of the case, they extended the time limit. There are key things to take away from that. Children and young people are at an inherent disadvantage. Very often the support they receive from the corporate parent against whom they may be taking a case. Many children looked after many children they're actually looked after and guided by that corporate parent. They may be unaware of the ability to take the case or be fearful to do so. And so they need an independent third party to help them access that justice. And then you've got the bureaucracy. They need to instruct a lawyer, they need to qualify and obtain legal aid, we need to engage an advocate. So actually the real burden lies on the child, not on the public authority here. The second point from my example is that public authorities will use every tool in their legal arsenal to defend a litigation. Okay, and it's right that they're able to do so. And it's right that their advocates, whether it's Janice or anybody else, and their legal team advises them as such. That is fair and proper. If the tool is in the shed, then they will use it, and regardless of the age of the child, there shouldn't be any uncertainty about that. So the fact that the current law in Scotland around time limits is robust, back at Janice's example of the Supreme Court is one example. The Outer House has held this year that time limits run from when a decision is made, not even from when a person knows about it. So these time limits and these strict procedures as they are represent a barrier to children taking cases at present. And I suppose the last thing I would say is that there are other hurdles that need to be cleared in order to take a judicial review. A case that comes in the example has been given and some evidence I've read cases being taken 10, 15 years later. If it's a judicial review, the young person also needs to prove merit. And if a case is stale, that can be taken into account, I would expect, by a judge at permission stage. Those are probably the things that I would say about the bill. I think the committee has two options. The way it is, or if they were not mined to, the discretion to extend should be far more explicit and wide in order to take into account the specific circumstances of children. Sorry for my long answer.
Well, thank you. It was very helpful, and I think it does aid the committee to have specific examples of what this means to real life young people, and not just be talking about things in the abstract all the time. Kay, do you have any thing you wish to share with the committee on Gillian's questions there about court proceedings and the time limits?
Well, I've had the benefit of listening this morning, so I would just shortly endorse the discussion about sufficient interest and to make sure those kind of intentions do come through in terms of the bill and the legislation. In time limits, again, very persuaded by Andy's presentation. And I think just to add to that is we do know from the research evidence that many children will not realise that they have their rights breached until they're older. So we know that. So that's very important under that intention of the government in those time limits. And just to pick a second example of the power imbalances. So we have heard from looked after children, for example, that they may find it difficult to take something in relation to their corporate parent until they're older. So it's another example of why we do need to really take a children's perspective to the time limits. Thank you.
Thank you. And if I could come to Fulton McGregor now, please, Fulton.
Thanks, convener, and good morning, panel. I wanted to continue on with the line of questioning that I did for the previous panel, for those of you who've seen it. And I suppose it actually falls on quite nicely from the exchanges that we've just had there. And that's about the availability of the existing courts and tribunals to children and young people. I'd like to ask the panel if they think that these existing services are accessible, and if not, what improvements can be required here. And we did get quite a lot of good evidence on the record in the last session, so I'm wondering if the panel members could specifically think about ways in which the perhaps court and tribunal services could be made better. For example, in the criminal world, there's a lot of talk about the Barnhouse model, for example. Is this something that we could be looking at more here in order for children to access their rights? And I'm happy with the order of the panel as they come in.
Okay, thank you. Morag, if we come to you first, please.
It's always very difficult. Law, by its nature, tends to be complex. Sorry. Its interpretation of statute, it is not by its nature particularly child friendly. We've had some improvements brought in the Children Scotland Act 2020, which gives children more choice in how they wish to express a view. But participation in court and tribunals is not, we have to remember that there are different sorts of rights. Children may have passive rights, that we have a duty to make sure they have a right to be educated. The child doesn't have to take any active steps. It's up to the grown-ups to do it. It comes to rights that the child needs to take a step to do, to give their view, to ask to be excused from a hearing, to make the complaint in the first place. We're asking them to participate in what is a complex and adult forum. And we've made improvements, but we're not there. The children and young people who have come forward to you are, I'm afraid, not the majority. Very many children, especially children that are living with trauma, children with certain types of disability, they are less likely to be able to be aware that something has gone wrong, or that they had a right to something, or to understand the right or the context. And it's very much dependent on the services we provide. We're only now, 9 years after the 2011 Act came into force, actually providing advocacy services for hearings. It's difficult, and we need more understanding among the adult services that we need to observe children's rights. An example, children have a right as well as a duty to attend a children's hearing. They can be excused under certain circumstances. It is not at all uncommon in my experience for children to be excused without being asked if they want to go, or when they have been excused and said, but I wanted to go, being told by an overprotective adult, no, you don't, you've been excused, you're not going. So it's not just a matter of giving the child a right. We have to be able to have those who are able to make the right real for the child to take the steps. And this is where a lot of the scheme, which will be the next thing we're looking at, this is where we need the duties to be made very clear. But we want to stop things before they get to court. And earlier this morning, somebody was talking about child-friendly complaint system. In our response, we actually mentioned, should we have a child-compatible way of doing this rather than adapting the adult court to the child or adapting the child to the adult court? You know, which way do we go? Too often we're trying to put a bandage with a teddy bear on it onto the problem, rather than approaching it from what do children actually need in order to be able to exercise their rights? Because they're all too often children that are already dealing with very difficult, complex situations. You can lose capacity temporarily due to trauma. You know, what do we do? So it's very complex. This is a big help, and I'm so glad the Children's Commissioner has the powers. But when we talk about accessibility, I sometimes wonder whether we're coming at it from the wrong angle and look at what do children need and how do we adapt the system to the child rather than make ways of the child adapting to the adult system. Sorry to go on. Bit of a hobby horse there.
No, that was really useful.
Janice, if I can come to you next, please.
Thank you very much. I have to declare an interest here, as my primary practice is in family law. And over the years I've been in practice, I've seen a culture change, which I think is what we need and what is encouraged in terms of this bill. We have seen the courts more willing to hear from children, more willing to have children as parties in proceedings. And over recent years, I have represented more children in court. But the position across Scotland, I think it's fair to say, is quite patchy. And that's always going to be so in the cultural context. One of the things which is going to help this hugely is the empowerment of the Children and Young Person Scotland Commissioner. I think the Commissioner has a big role in this, in assisting children if they wish to participate. But the bill is a step in the right direction. Can I just take a step back to Mary Fee's question? I've discovered where the question about tribunals came from. And it was a question based upon Section 9 of your bill and whether the children's hearing is exempt from damages or whether it counts as a tribunal and cannot therefore be asked to award damages. It's just something that it may be worth clarifying.
Thank you. Andy, Fulton's questions there, if you...
Yes. I just have a couple of short points. I endorse what Morag and Janice said. In particular, the culture change. I would agree. I've also seen it as well. We are able now more than ever to ask and use existing court rules in order to make court quote unquote child friendly. Whether that's the right approach, whether that's the right lens to be viewing it through, is a different matter. I know that Morag's asking this question: do we adapt the adult courts for children, or do we just create something else for children? And that is a question I'm not particularly qualified to offer a view on. What I would say is this. With respect to this bill and this evidence session, there's a distinction between incorporation and implementation. What should be on the face of this bill in order to create existing remedies and make them in order to make existing remedies more accessible? And what is something that comes after the bill? I think that on the face of the bill, measures like the time limit, measures like beefing up remedies like the strike down clause, declarations of incompatibility, making them more robust, does that. It improves the quality of the remedy. Declarations of incompatibility, as they are in the Human Rights Act, are actually not compliant with the rights and effective remedy under the European Convention. That was called Burden Against the UK in 2006. But adding in this additional requirement for ministers to report on a declaration of incompatibility is a positive step. It actually means that something, there's an imperative for something to actually be done about it. In fact, I think that the bill could perhaps even go further and say they should. That we have learned hard lessons in Scotland, I'm afraid, for around declarations of incompatibility. For example, there was a declaration of incompatibility passed in 2007 or set down in 2007 in a case called Smith Scott to do with prisoner voting, which reconfirmed that the Hurst number 2 case against the UK on prisoner voting should be implemented. And it wasn't done until this year, a 13-year delay on the back of a declaration of incompatibility. This bill should make sure that does not happen for children's rights, and I think it goes some way towards doing that. The question around courts and tribunal itself, that feels to me like more of an implementation issue around whether there is, how else can we adapt what we have, or do we create something new? That's a big piece of work. I'm not particularly qualified to offer any more insight into that.
Thank you. Kay, if we could come to you now, please.
Yes, well, thank you. And I just think this is such an important area and such an important issue that's being raised here. One of the big benefits of a children's rights approach is about accountability, and that it's so important to have just, effective and appropriate redress and remedy. And largely, we would know from our evidence from children and young people that largely we are not very accessible. There are some good examples we can learn from. I think to add in the additional support needs tribunal, we know is working extremely hard to try to do this, and I think there's a lot of learning from there. But I do agree with Andy about a bit of a step back. In fact, on November 27th, we can give our conclusions to the committee. We are having a seminar with the Children's Commissioner around the Children's Scotland Bill, bringing in the children's views from the bill to address this very thing about what is redress in terms of that context. But might I suggest from that, we do need to be thinking of the package as has been discussed this morning, but at the very least, I suggest at the baseline is that cultural understanding change. Secondly, advocacy. There are increasing number of advocacy being available for children, and we know the Scottish Government wants to join them up. This is an opportunity to do so. Child-friendly complaints has been mentioned. But that's quite radical. When we did research for the Children's Commissioner in England, even just the idea of a child understanding and wanting to make a complaint was actually quite a big hurdle to do. So can we think of complaints as positive things rather than as something that a public authority, for example, might not want to hear? And then access to justice is big. You will know that we are critical of the legal age changes that really prevented children sometimes accessing legal aid. But there's a whole area in that I think that needs to be addressed. As a result, our suggestion is that this should be a requirement for the children's rights scheme, that it should be required that this be addressed, that we suggest in the face of the bill to make sure we really make sure this cornerstone for the children's rights approach is really and regularly considered. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. And I know Alexandra Stewart has some questions around that. If I can just bring in Andy, who had a point he wished to make about legal aid there. Andy.
Thank you. Sorry, it's just a very, very brief point off the back of what he said there to do with legal aid. It's just merely for the record. I know I saw from the written evidence put forward even by the Legal Aid Board that and other parties that legal aid is something that's under review, I think, by ministers, and I just want to flag that I think that the committee should maybe have some consideration about whether something on the face of the bill relating to free access to legal advice is worth considering. It's in other legal instruments as well, for example, the trafficking directive, etc. But we have a problem in Scotland around eligibility criteria as they apply to children. First of all, the duty of alimony, which takes into account parental or other guardian resources. And second of all, the limits themselves. I work with care experience young people. Many of them receive the care experience bursary. That puts them within a part-time job of not being eligible for legal aid. I'm working most of my kids who are in their, most of my young people who are in their 19 or early 20s, if they work at Nando's and receive their care experience bursary, or if they work at Marks and Spencer's, they don't qualify for legal aid. And we need to work for them pro bono. So that's something, that's a serious access to justice.
Thank you for making those important points. Andy Fulton, can I bring you in again?
Yeah, thanks, Convener. Just a brief follow-up to that, and I know that some of the panellists actually touched on it already, and that's about part two of the bill. Do you think that it goes far enough to ensure that judicial remedies that can be provided by courts and tribunals will be effective in practice for children and young people? And Convener, I'm aware that some colleagues are requiring to leave to get into Edinburgh, so I'm quite happy, you know, with your permission, that if I address that question to Dr. Boyle and Laura Driscoll and Janice Scott, but anybody else can come in.
Of course, if other panel members wish to add, they can request in the chat box there. Morag, Fulton's question there about part two.
Well, I think it's not a simple question. It's an improvement. It's a big improvement. I think some of the points made earlier about who the duties on this stuff not shouldn't just be Scottish ministers, but the Parliament is an important one. But I think what I would go back to is the question about who can raise the action, and apart from access to justice, but I think it goes back to that, and I don't really have anything to add to the stuff that by the practitioners earlier, so I think this is another one to go back to Janice.
Okay, thank you. Janice.
I don't want to waste time.
Thank you. What it does, what part two does, is allow all the tools that we've got in our current toolbox to be used on behalf of children, and unless you're going to go further and invent more tools, then it's as effective as you can make it in the current context of the current bill. I take Andy's point about legal aid, and that certainly does need looking at in order to make sure that this is going to be effective for children. But so far, so good.
Okay, thank you. And if we can move on to Alec O'Hamilton there, please.
Thank you very much, Convener. Good morning to the panel. I'm going to ask you similar questions to the first panel, and that starts with the recognition that the UNCRC is a baseline. It's not the best practice. It's what the international community regards as the bare minimum. Can we, in all conscience, incorporate the UNCRC while we still have, for example, age of criminal responsibility below the international baseline that the committee has set, albeit through a general comment? And is there a moral imperative of us to scan right across all of the articles to make sure that we are at the very threshold, if not above it, before we can legitimately claim to have created this important convention?
Well, of course, the Law Society doesn't really comment on moral attitudes or whatever in this, but we did argue that the age of criminal responsibility should have been raised to 14 at the time. I would like, just on a personal basis, I'd like to see Scotland taking a lead on these things, but it's much more of a matter for part than for the Law Society to recommend. I think one needs to be careful.
Thank you. Janice.
Well, you have a huge and aspirational set of articles in the UNCRC. And as was mentioned in your earlier panel, this is a living instrument. So the way that it is read and interpreted will develop over time. It's important that we don't see this as a static matter, that we look at it as a matter that requires constant review. There are huge numbers of areas which you'd have to look at, not just the age of criminal responsibility. And I can give you just run off a few examples from recent litigation in the last month. What about children deprived of their liberty in children's homes? They're not approved for that purpose. Does that comply with Article 3.3? In terms of Article 24, does our child and mental health service comply with what we're requiring for children in terms of Article 27, or do we have a big issue there? When we're looking at Article 37, we have the Children's Commissioner's issue of no safe place. Are we using restraint and seclusion inappropriately in relation to children with additional support needs in Scottish schools? Are our education rights all right? What about adequate standards of living? Do we look at top-up benefits? This is absolutely huge. And so you have set a challenge. Okay, they're minimal standards, but you have to appreciate this is something that's quite large, which is why the faculty said, hang on a minute, have you actually costed this out? I don't want to discourage you. I mean, children's rights are important. But if this bill is going to have teeth, there's a lot of work to be done and quite a lot of money to be spent. Sorry.
Thank you. Andy.
So my answer will be relatively short. I think that the point, I think, in response to the question is that this bill allows us to pull ourselves up by our bootstraps. You know, if there are aspects of children's law in Scotland that are not meeting the minimum standard, then this bill is going to make it happen. And how that happens is up to us. It is either going to be through the effective work of the building scheme and of the impact assessments and of the reporting duties and, you know, time and space, although not too much time, but time and space, and as Janet quite rightly says, you know, money in order to bring in compliance. Or it's going to be done through litigation where there are serious faults, where we're below that floor. And if it's the latter, then it will be done quicker than the former. But I don't want to put the fear into anybody. I don't think there's a pack of opportunistic lawyers at the door baying for blood. That's not the case. You know, as I said before, as a practitioner who works directly with children, you know, we don't want to be going to court. So I see this as an opportunity for us to, rather than thinking, should we do this because we might not meet all the requirements yet, I think we should say, well, actually doing this will allow us the requirement in the long run. It is a not insubstantial task, as Janice has said, and I agree with what she said. I would encourage to read COSLA's written evidence, as well as the evidence of other local authorities. You know, they are a good litmus test for us to see how they view the task, and their view was very much like, we're already doing this. You know, if we do need something, we need a little bit more time, but it's not an impossible task. Why I'm encouraged that there's political will, there's will on the ground, and you know, nothing's impossible.
Thank you. Kay.
I am able to say that I think it's a moral imperative. I think we must incorporate, and the bill is an excellent start for that. I might add in, the committee may well know, but there was the research commissioned by UNICEF that did look at incorporation, I believe, in 12 countries, done by our colleagues Laura Lundy, Ursula, et cetera. And again, as you may know, they really found that it did not substantially increase litigation. Right? And particularly what it was helpful was about changing culture and practice. And I think our discussion here today has really emphasized that that's what we want to do. So again, if we invest in that, we do have the evidence to suggest that while litigation has to be there as a possibility, it's not necessarily a tie to incorporation.
Thank you. Alec.
Thank you. I mean, the one reflection I would offer to Andy in his response is that the articles of the convention are actually silent on the minimum age of criminal responsibility, and the we set it through the general comments, and under the terms of our incorporation here, those general comments would not be justiciable. So I would take issue with the fact that it will automatically happen as a result of litigation. I think we actually need to push that ourselves. It is a living document, and it's shaped by the interpretation of optional protocols, of general comments, and indeed concluding observations of UN rapporteurs. Are the panel content that the bill has a sufficient feedback loop built into it so that the government is compelled to respond and adapt based on those three areas, the general comments, concluding obs and optional protocols?
So I appreciate that the panel members have reflected on some of this in Mary Fee's questioning, but if there are additional things you wish to add, we'd be happy to hear.
It's all right, I can move on to my final question.
Okay.
And that is on commencement. And we've touched on this lightly, but already, because I asked it at the last panel. But the Act is only as good as it's only meaningful when it comes into being. And at this time, there is no date for that, nor is there a date for the age of criminal responsibility. But can you tell us any reason why it should be delayed? How quickly do you think we could bring this in? And should we define a date in the bill itself?
This is a big piece of work that will have to be done. There will be a lot of work in the background. Local authorities, public bodies will have a lot of work and will be waiting for guidance, which will have to emanate from. I can't see it coming into force by Christmas. If you put in a date, it has to be very realistic. I would agree with the comments made earlier that it would be useful as long as it's a realistic one. But I also would agree with the comments about bringing the scheme. When are the first reports going to be due? You know, when are we going to hear about this? And the other thing that's so important when it comes to doing something new with children, you can come up with a little way of doing something, but when are you going to review it to see if it's working? Whether it needs to be adapted more. And I would like to see something of saying the first review of the new changes will be done within a certain period. Because if you're doing something new with kids, you need to, and especially with a living document like the CRC, you do need, are we still complying? Have there been changes? What do we need to do now? So I would say I would build that sort of thing in. But the commencement, a realistic date, because I wouldn't like to see another 9 years go by.
Janice, if we can come to you now, please.
Yes, of course. If you can imagine sitting down with a child and giving them advice that says, well, of course, you have rights in terms of the UNCRC here, and it would be just lovely to be able to ask a court to enforce a public authority to do what the UNCRC says, but really sorry, it's not happened yet, and I don't know when it's going to happen. I think if you're raising expectations of children and young people in terms of this bill, you owe it to children and young people to say when it's going to happen. I accept the point that there has to be a realistic timetable so there could be preparation for it, but I think it would be a great disappointment not to set that timetable and have the Act brought into force as soon as you can.
Thank you. Andy?
I am in agreement with Morag and Janice. I and Professor Norrie in the previous session as well said, you know, a date focuses minds. Now, when that date is, it's not my job to provide that, thankfully. And I appreciate there are balancing, there are considerations to be balanced on either side, but a date certainly focuses minds. I certainly don't want to be the person that's delivering bad news to my young people about this Act coming in and then it not being in force until my client's 21 years old. That would be pretty unpleasant. I suppose the last thing I would say about the date is that leaving up to ministerial discretion could put it into the long grass. And what I always worry about is what I call future-proofing. We live in a very strange world, and if we were to transport ourselves to 6 years in the future, and in Scotland happened to be governed by a right skeptic party or a group of persons, maybe weren't interested in this at all, and there was no date in which it would come in, and it was left to ministerial discretion, then it might never come in. And we can't be complacent. And so I would like to see a date on there that, in consultation with your colleagues at local government, is realistic. You know, we don't want to rush things and come out with bad procedures. We want to get this right, but also is prompt.
Thank you. Kay, please.
Thank you. I agree. I think there needs to be a commencement date on the face of the bill. To pick up a bit on Morag's point, I think that aspect about reviewing and monitoring implementation is absolutely key. And you'll know that we're suggesting, I think perhaps the Children's Rights Scheme would be the key place to put it, is we do actually have lots of statistics in Scotland, but they're not answering our children's rights questions. So there's actually quite an urgent need, I think, to think systematically how we can do that. But I think that actually would be a big step forward.
Okay, thank you. And on that, I'll bring in Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, convener. I'm going to stick to similar questions that I asked panel one about the right scheme and also the wellbeing impact assessment. And already this morning, members of this panel have touched on that. But when we spoke at the last panel, there was some identification that gaps may be there or that there would be opportunities to develop the scheme and the assessments. So if I can ask the panel, if we can think of the scheme itself, as we already identified, language in the bill could be stronger. That was identified previously. It would be good to get the views of members of this panel if they believe that is still the case, and that if there is anything that requires to be added or changed into the content of the scheme itself, what would that be? And then when you look at the wellbeing assessment and impact assessment, it's important to, we've discussed already today, the discretion that Scottish ministers would have and will have in this whole process. And it would be good once again to get the views of this panel about what do they think that Scottish ministers should have discretion in relation to decisions of a strategic nature and how this would impact on the processes that we've identified so far, taking evidence and also during the evidence session today.
Thank you. Kay, you mentioned the rights scheme there in your last answer, so I wonder if we come to you first to continue.
That's a change, but yes. I think overall, I believe the committee knows that a scheme in Wales has proved very successful, and we can learn from that, but it can be very effective. So I think paying attention to this makes a great deal of sense. So as you will have gathered, I was just slipping in my comments before to make sure we had time, but overall, I do think the scheme should be strengthened. And in 11.3, there should be some things that are required to be in the scheme. So that would include, I phrased it as promoting understanding. I'm not quite sure why the wording of the 2014 Act, which is going to be repealed, is not being put in here, because it was argued that that was more, stronger, and it was about understanding as well. So that's a technical but perhaps important point. But I've made the point that I think children's redress scheme and children's rights indicators should be here as well. Secondly, and I was reading Together's evidence, I believe you'll be hearing from Together, there's a strategic approach and also as they consider appropriate. So there's at least two discretionary elements. And in my view, I think Together's suggestion is, do we need as they consider appropriate, perhaps could be taken away. And if it's good to raise here the third point, you'll know that we are supportive of public authorities having to do a children's rights and wellbeing impact assessment too. In fact, we're working with some public authorities in terms of that. That's a really positive thing in terms of taking children's rights forward. Thank you.
Thank you. Morag.
Well, what Kay just said is spot on. I would like to see it being a very clear document. If this is going to be so essential and so important, the language in it must be careful and clear, and there should be more obligations. The discretion thing, it can water it down. And I really have nothing further to add.
Janice, do you have any thing you wish to share on those topics?
Well, it's not an area in which the Faculty of Advocates operates, so I don't think I've got anything useful to add. I was interested in Kay saying that the Welsh scheme had been successful. It must have been a disappointment to see a couple of weeks ago it was a Welsh child being debated in the Supreme Court whose rights were being overlooked, and that was being defended by the Welsh government. These things have to be made effective. That was a case where a child had been detained in unauthorised accommodation and her liberty had been taken away.
Okay, thank you. Andy, do you have any comments on the child's rights scheme and these rights and wellbeing impact assessments at all?
Just two very brief comments, and they've been made before. For the record, I would recommend that section 11, subsection 3, where it says the scheme may, I think that should say the scheme must. I could be convinced otherwise, but I'm not entirely grasping why it would be discretionary to ensure children are able to participate in the making of decisions that affect them. A relatively clear-cut intention of the bill. Similarly, at section 13, subsection, am I right? Hang on. Sorry, section 14, subsection 3. Similarly, it's relating to discretion. You know, as a lawyer, when you read these technical things and you see the Scottish ministers must, you think, oh. And then at the end, it says, as they consider appropriate, which negates the must. So it's just a short drafting point, and it's to do with whether this is going to be discretionary or not, and that's a decision for the committee to make. Children's rights scheme and CREWAs are not my personal expertise, so I'm not going to be able to offer anything else beyond what Kay has said and what I'm sure together and other individuals will say. But again, the future-proofing aspect of this is really important for me. If we put in things that tell future governments, future parliaments, they need to do these things, then I feel a bit safer. with that. So that's kind of why I would maybe deter away from the discretionary element.
Suppose in terms of expectation setting, we can't bind the future too tightly, but I do take on board what you're saying. Alexander, do you have any further questions, or are you content with those?
I'm content, convener, with the answers I've received. Thank you so much.
Okay. If I could just ask a final question about court powers to determine compatibility. Andy, you did touch on this on a previous answer. Part 4 of the bill sets out quite significant powers of courts to make declarators, it's a difficult word for me to say, in respect of incompatible legislation. Do you have any further comments on part 4? And I think the committee would be particularly interested in whether you accept the view of the Scottish Government that strike down powers for future primary legislation are not within the legislative competence of the Scottish Parliament. We're going to Andy now.
Sorry, thank you. My views on strike down are that it is a very strong remedy. It is one that I like to see. I like the safeguards that are also built into it with respect to passing notification to the Lord Advocate and to the Children's Commissioner. I think this allows us to think very carefully around, you know, what is quite a very robust remedy and allows it to be used appropriately. The Scottish Government's views relating to strike down not being able to be applied to future legislation speaks to devolved versus reserved, the ultra vires powers under Section 29 of the Scotland Act. I think on balance, it's right. That is a restriction in terms of competence. What I find interesting, and I don't know the answer to this question, I'd need to apply my mind to it in more detail, is whether the same problem arises if we included the Scottish Parliament under Section 6, whether that would be tantamount to something similar. Perhaps not, but it was something, when I heard it raised earlier in the earlier panel, I thought, would that not be doing the same thing? And so that's maybe something for further exploration. In terms of declarations of incompatibility, I've already said, and I like the additional in place there over and above the Human Rights Act. I would like to see a requirement that a minister do something within their discretion as to what they do actually something more explicit in the Act around that. And I think that is all I have to say. Is there a part of your question I haven't answered? I can't
remember. No, I think you've covered that quite fully. I'll go to other members of the panel if they would wish to give their opinions on that. Janice, I wonder if I could come to you. I see Morag and Kay shaking their heads, and you didn't. So.
No, I didn't. It comes back to the point I made at the beginning. As a litigator, I would far rather go for a read down than a declaration of incompatibility, because a read down gives the person I'm representing an immediate remedy in a compliant reading of the legislation. And that has been very, very widely interpreted by the House of Lords and the Supreme Court. So I think Section 19 is a great part of the bill. Declarations of incompatibility don't actually give you your remedy, it just says the law's wrong, so it doesn't help you, the person you're representing. As for the compatibility point that you raised, that's a big constitutional issue, and I don't think that in giving evidence to a committee it would be appropriate for me to express a view on that, because it's a complex issue. I like the point that ministers are under an obligation to
Sorry, Janice, you have frozen there. I don't know if you can.
I can see what happens.
Janice, we lost some of your answer there. I wonder if you were about to talk about the duty to report. You said what I like, and then you froze. I wonder if I could just ask you to repeat.
I liked the point, Andy's point, that there was something has to be done about this. You don't just leave it hanging. But my final point was there are some big constitutional issues in any domestic legislation that has an interplay with international instruments, and also in the context of a devolved legislation. So we are going to have some interesting work to do as and when this bill becomes law.
Thank you very much. I believe that draws our session to a conclusion this morning. I thank Morag Driscoll, Janice Scott, Andy Cyril and Professor Kay Tisdall for your evidence. It's been really helpful and valuable to us. If there's anything that you go away and think you didn't have the opportunity to say or submit to us, please do feel free to follow up, and we may well be back in touch by correspondence. That concludes the public part of this morning's meeting, and the next meeting of the committee will be on Thursday, the 19th of November, where we will continue to take evidence on UNCRC. As previously agreed, we'll now move into private session, and I suspend this meeting. Thank you.